Hello, everyone. I'm your host, Maria Cosette. You're tuned into MStage. And today I'm very excited because I have two very talented young producers talking about their feature film Searching in theaters now, Sevak Ohanian and Natalie Qasabian. What's up, guys?
Hi.
Hello.
Nice to see you.
Likewise. Thanks. I'm so happy to have you here. I really, really am.
Thank you for having me.
So I want to start off by saying congratulations on all your recent accomplishments. And let's jump into the film, talk about it. All right. So once again, it's in theaters now, everybody. And I know that it's a thriller. Mm-hmm. However, it's also an emotional journey about a father losing his daughter and how he comes about finding about all these different things about her that he didn't know before. So what was the inspiration of this very unique concept?
Yeah. Oh, man. Well, okay. So you said it perfectly. Searching is a thriller about a father searching for his missing daughter.
Right.
And the way he goes about trying to find her is he goes to her laptop. So in the process of trying to find clues as he's breaking into her privacy, he starts to learn things about her that he never imagined.
Or maybe didn't want to know even.
Exactly. And the crazy thing about the movie is that it takes place entirely on computer devices.
Yes. So let's talk about that. It's super unique. What kind of feedback have you guys gotten so far from people, because it's such a relevant topic?
Yeah, I mean, it's the reaction has been huge, honestly, like beyond our wildest dreams. Like everyone that sees it, from younger generation to older generation, just comes out like blown away. And I think more than anything, because despite the fact that it's on screens, it's a really emotional story. It's about this father,
right?
You know, realizing that he didn't know his daughter. And, you know, while we're telling you with all this technology and it's commenting on that, really at its core, it's a story about a family.
Right.
And a family trying to come back together.
And the reaction's been amazing. Like, this movie is a movie that we made with our good friend Anish Chaganti. It's his first ever feature film.
First time.
Natalie and I have produced a bunch of indies in the past. And, you know, it's a difficult movie to explain. Like, you know, it's hard to even imagine this film until you've seen it. And we would have considered just us finishing the movie to be a success.
Yeah.
We would have been very happy with that, period. The fact that, you know, we made the movie, we got into, we premiered at the Sundance Film Festival a couple of months ago.
Or just to back up, we made it independently.
Exactly.
It's being released by Sony now. But yeah, made it totally independently, which meant, you know, it was low budget, it was scrappy, you know, a small team of people that really like came together to make this happen.
Right.
And then we were really lucky to go and premiere it at the Sundance Film Festival in January of this year.
Please let's talk about that journey, because first of all, both of you are young. And I feel like that's like a mom, I made it kind of moment, you know? It's a big deal. So let's talk about that emotional journey. Like, how was that, you know, the whole thing?
Okay, so Sundance is North America's biggest film festival.
Right.
Like, the biggest movies that you can imagine in the last 20 years have a lot of them have premiered there.
A lot of the filmmakers that kind of end up in the studio world are launched from Sundance.
Right,
exactly.
Exactly.
Like, the odds of getting a movie into Sundance is like what, less than getting into Harvard or something?
It's easier to get into Harvard.
Yeah. I did not know that.
It's crazy.
Yeah. And you swept an award.
We got a couple of awards, but just the fact that if Sundance had told us, hey, you guys, we like your movie, we're going to play it and the men's bathroom stall.
We would have been excited.
We would have been like, great, like victory for sure. But, you know, they gave us a great premiere and, you know, we screened it for real audience. And
our families actually came out. My
family,
Sevak's family.
Yeah.
And Anisha's family, and the three of them, like all three families had a big dinner together. And it was totally that moment. Like you said, it was like our parents were just so proud.
And, you know, we premiered the movie, and I remember I was terrified of just the audience reaction. Like, we knew we had made a good movie, but you just never know. And then...
It's nerve-wracking to have people, you know, because it's like we made it, you know, by ourselves for so long, and then to have it on the big screen.
I know,
And the reaction was crazy. Like, people were clapping, people were, like, crying.
People were sitting on the edge of their seats, too, throughout. Like, we literally saw people go... like during the twists and the turns. So it was like an amazing feeling.
There was a very famous celebrity in the premiere, who I'm not supposed to say her name, I guess.
Okay.
She's like an A-list celebrity, you probably know what I'm talking about, who had to leave the screening halfway through because I think she had an appointment or something.
Oh, okay.
And I heard she was cursing outside because she was so angry she couldn't see the ending of the movie.
She left like right at the climax, so she had no idea what happened after.
She's like, why?
Yeah.
So it was like crazy for us. And then, you know, the dream of having a movie at Sundance is that a distributor or a studio will buy the film and then put it in theaters. We premiered a movie at 6:30 p.m.
Yep.
We went to our after party, like our premiere party.
Yep.
But about an hour into our party, our agents came and grabbed us and said, we have to go.
We're like, where are we?
We're like, we're at our party. We're celebrating the movie. Yeah. And they were like, we all have to go right now. Let's go. And we realized what was happening was they were saying that people wanted to come by the movie. And they didn't wait till the next morning.
So you had a bigger celebration afterwards.
Yeah. Well, we stayed up till 6 a.m. the next morning.
Right.
Meeting with distributors.
In the middle of the night.
Middle of the night, hearing all these people like, we want to buy your movie for this much or that much. And then 6 a.m. we decided we're going with Sony. We threw back a shot of whiskey.
Oh my God, I forgot about that.
Because you got to do something like that. And then we went and tried to sleep, but we were just so excited.
Yeah, so it was an incredible, incredible journey just to get there.
Yeah, I can imagine. And that's actually perfect. So let's check out the trailer so that everybody could see. This is Searching in theaters now. Check out the trailer.
Let's take a picture. One, two, three.
Hey, sweetheart. Where are you?
Study group. As you get back.
Great. Oh, one more thing. I want to know about the final you took today.
Leave me a message or text me back.
Hi, sweetheart. Just checking in because it looks like you already left for school this morning.
Hey, Margot. Dad again.
Why did you leave your laptop at home?
I haven't been able to reach Margot.
Wait, you can't find Margot?
Study group only went till 9.
She said it was going all night.
No, she definitely left at 9.
Authorities are asking anyone with information to please call the hotline or 911 immediately.
Update me whenever you learn something.
Did she mention anything unusual going on lately?
We're not really that close.
But you guys are friends.
Kind of.
She has friends, right? She keeps to herself a lot.
She's quiet.
I did see her eat lunch alone.
On Thursday?
Every day.
She made an outgoing transaction of $2,500.
Margot picked up an ID a few days ago.
That doesn't make any sense.
It's time to start considering that Margot ran away.
I know my daughter. She did not run away.
This is it. Best place in the world to do nothing.
This is her keychain.
You told me she ran away!
The vehicle was discovered late last night.
$2,500 in cash was found.
Something doesn't add up.
Has anyone considered that it was an absolute stranger?
You can't see things clearly.
All I'm trying to do is to help you find my daughter.
We need nothing from you.
Where were you the night my daughter went missing?
We are back with Sevak Ohanian and Natalie Qasabian, producers of the movie Searching in theaters everywhere now. Hi, guys.
Hello.
Hi. So that was an awesome trailer. And let's talk about John Cho. So we all know him from movies like Harold and Kumar, mm-hmm. Star Trek, dynamic, versatile actor. He's great. And I know that this particular role was written for him. Mm-hmm. So let's talk about the casting, like Deborah Messing and all the other fantastic actors that are in the film.
Go you want to start?
you're okay. A writer, so
John,
you should.
All right, so John Cho was always the guy we wanted to cast in this film. We wrote the part David Kim because, look, we're both Armenian. Our partner Anish is Indian American. Mm-hmm. We've all grown up watching so many movies that, you know, are thrillers and action movies, the kind of film we wanted Searching to be.
Right.
And they never star people that look like us, right? They always star the same kind of person. And there's a lot of movies that are made that are about representation and race and diversity. We love those movies. We want to make those movies, and we have made those movies. Yeah. This isn't one of them. Searching is a thriller about a father. It's not about an Asian father. It's about a father.
Right.
And in our strategy was if we cast John Cho and never make a reference to the fact that he's Asian or it's a Asian American family, we just want to normalize it, right? We're hoping that 10 years from now, people will look back at this film mm-hmm. and wonder, like, what was the big deal? You know, like, so that's kind of a rambling way of saying, like, our idea was to just cast him because he was Asian, but at the same time because it doesn't even matter. Does that make any sense?
It makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, it makes sense.
And with Deborah, we were just, when we were looking at the character, she plays a character called Detective Vic. She's the lead investigator on the case. We were just really trying to think outside the box. Like, who have we not seen in a serious role like this?
You know what? I was just going to say that. And that's so nice to see them in that kind of light.
Yeah. And just, you know, why not give, you know, a comedic actress a chance to play a dramatic role? We don't see that enough.
Right.
And we're just big fans of her. I remember when we cast her, the first thing Anish and I did was call our moms.
Cause
both of our moms are like big Will and Grace fans.
Yeah.
And they flipped out.
Grace is in our film.
Yeah. My mom flipped out.
You know what's crazy? Deborah is the nicest human being on the planet. She invited all of us to a taping of Will and Grace a few weeks ago.
Really? That's
and,
so sweet.
And you brought your mom as your guest.
It was so special to see. Like, I was just watching my mom's face instead of watching them tape. It was amazing.
Right. I love it. Since we're on the topic of females, Natalie,
sure.
I'd like to commend you on all the accomplishments and work you've done, because it's very challenging to be a female in the entertainment industry.
I got you.
Oh, thank you, lovey. But no, honestly, and so being a producer on the film, let's talk about the incredible work it takes, you know, from inception to completion.
Yeah, I mean, female or not, you know, the independent world is, it's really challenging. You're doing everything with like little resources. We were talking about this earlier.
Right.
You know, you're wearing multiple hats. And then at times, you know, to be a woman and to be doing all those things, there's like an extra little challenge there because, you know, it's small things. I think a lot of people think it's like these overt, you know, differences between men and women in the workplace. It's not, it's, you know, sometimes it's small things like, you know, we'd be in meetings together. And for example, one of the things I was in charge of was the budget, and we'd be going over the budget with the production company, and you know, certain people would not make eye contact with me, even though I was the one presenting the information. So it's little things like that. But very lucky that I work with, you know, Sevak, obviously, who's nothing but supportive, and Anish, our director. And I think it just comes down to like surrounding yourself with people who are blind to that and just see you at, you know, for the value of the, of the work that you're contributing.
You did good. I'm proud. I love it.
Thank you.
So stay with us. MStage, I'm Maria Cosette. I'm here with Sevak Ohanian, Natalie Qasabian. We have much more to come, talking about the movie Searching in theaters everywhere now. Hey guys, we're back with MStage. I'm your host, Maria Cosette, and I'm here with the very talented duo, Natalie Qasabian and Sevak Ohanian, producers of the movie Searching, in theaters now everywhere. So I encourage all of you to go see it. And so let's get back to our awesome discussion here. Yes. I want to convey the importance of you know, the first weekend of a movie's wide release. Why is it important for people to go, the box office numbers, the reputation of the movie, the whole thing?
So it's very important, and that's a good point.
Yep.
Searching opened in limited release last weekend, like on August 24th, which was only 9 theaters across the nation.
Okay.
The good news is we won the box office that weekend. We had the highest per theater average. It shows that there was a lot of interest in the movie. But now it is officially out in wide release. Every city in America has the movie. Every country in the world is going to have it pretty soon.
That is so exciting.
It's playing in Armenia, actually.
September 27th in Yerevan. If you're going to be there, go see it.
I love that.
So excited.
But, you know, it's really important because it kind of, this is the weekend that shows to the studio behind the film and people that are paying attention that there's an interest in this movie. And people who go out and see the movie in theaters and buy the yummy popcorn and see it with their friends and family, that's the best way to show support of movies like this, especially because the movie's not based on a book, it's not based on a toy, it doesn't star The Rock for once, you know, like it's the kind of movie that's an original story by an original team of people with, you know, a very original way of telling that story. I think that this is the best way for people to show their support.
Absolutely, and it has 93% on Rotten Tomatoes.
94%, but like, who's counting?
Is it? You know, okay, like, I'm sorry. That 1%, no, that's okay. It makes a difference.
It's all good.
It's yes, 94% on Rotten Tomatoes.
But here's the thing about the movie, like, it's genuinely a roller coaster ride. I know everyone says that about their movie, but yeah, we love to sneak into the back of the theater and watch
audiences. We have evidence of people's reactions. Like, yeah. Again, dude, just like going crazy.
People gasp, people like start whispering
to each
other.
Or people talk to the screen. Like my mom, I keep talking about my mom today, but she literally speaks to the screen in like intense movies. And she was like, like asking questions and stuff.
Yeah. Yeah. Amazing. So let's talk about making this movie. The fact that generally speaking with producing a movie, I know people intensely go location scouting. And although there was some of that in this movie, it's predominantly, it involves a lot of multiple online platforms. So you guys would better explain that. Let's go into that. And how is the process in making it?
Yeah, totally. So the film is told basically through screens, through the devices we use.
Right.
Laptops, iPhones, things like that. And while in a traditional movie, usually you shoot on an indie movie like maybe 18 or 20 days. In this movie, despite the fact that we have, without giving anything away, car chases, we have stunts, we see, you know, the daughter, we see her age from like 3 years old up until 16 years old, a lot of crazy stuff. We only had 13 days to pull it off.
Wow.
13 days.
So we shot very quickly all the live action stuff, but we actually spent over a year, right, in the edit room putting it together.
So, and the editors, if you can remind me their names, because I want to make mention of it.
No, thank you.
Yeah, that's a lot of work that went into that.
It's Will Merrick and Nick Johnson.
Yes. And the reason you should know their names is because they're going to win a lot of awards. Yeah. I mean, we think that if anyone deserves any recognition for this film, it's those two guys.
They're incredibly talented.
Amazing.
Yeah, so basically, you know, we to make the movie, we had to recreate the entire internet one pixel at a time. That meant these poor guys literally were in a room, or as we like to call it, locked in a room.
Yeah, tiny room.
Just basically working 14 hours a day, one by one, putting the movie together. We became really religious during the making of this movie. And we started praying to the rainbow spinning circle god. Do you know what that is? You know when your like Mac computer crashes?
Oh no,
and that little tiny thing pops up that's just spinning the spinning ball? Every time that would pop up because the computer was crashing, we would just get on our knees and start praying and hoping it wouldn't erase all of our footage from the last 2 hours.
Yeah.
And usually it would. It would. So
it's nuts. I mean, like, usually there's been films that have been done on screens. Like, this concept isn't necessarily new. But in those screens, usually they're just screen capturing the monitor.
Right.
In this movie, not one frame is screen captured. So that means those poor editors, talented editors, Will and Nick actually created the graphics for everything one by one, and it just took an intense amount of time.
But it was worth it because the end result is an incredibly exciting and thrilling, something you've never seen before in cinema.
Wow, that is incredible. It really is. I want to talk about this clip that we have here, but you guys would set it up better. So let's talk about it because there is an Armenian in there.
There's an Armenian and you should set it up.
Okay, so this is a clip that happens early in the movie where David Kim, who's played by John Cho, is not sure where his daughter is. So he gets the phone number of her piano teacher and gives her a call to find out what's happened to his daughter. You'll see what happens in a scene, but one thing you should know is that the voice of the piano teacher is a woman named Sylvia Manassian.
Oh, yes.
Who's a very awesome Armenian woman who's a philanthropist and supports the arts and the Armenian community. She's been a great mentor to both Natalie and I. We wanted to cast somebody who would be authentic. She's not an actress. We had to beg her to do the part. And to Sylvia's credit, she wouldn't accept money.
Yeah,
she's like,
so
can
cute.
You donate my money to charity? We were like, Sylvia, like, we have to pay you, Sylvia.
Like, it's a proper production. Please take it.
All right. And the last thing I'll say is the picture that we put for the piano teacher is actually my mom's picture.
Ah, that's cool. Yeah. So she's in the movie.
Yeah. Yep.
Very cool. So let's watch the clip from Searching in Theaters Everywhere now. Check it out.
Hello.
Hi, Mrs. Ohanian?
Yes.
This is David Kim, Margot's father.
Yes, I'm in the middle of a lesson. May I call you back afterwards?
Right, no, this will just take a second. Can you put my daughter on the phone just for a second?
I'm sorry, Mr. Kim. I'm confused what you're calling about.
My daughter, Margot Kim, is in a lesson with you right now?
Margot Kim canceled her classes 6 months ago.
What?
Is she looking to restart lessons?
Hold on, that doesn't make any sense. She loves piano.
Mr. Kim, is everything okay?
Yes, everything's fine. Thank you. Thank you, Mrs. Ohanian.
We are back with Sevak Ohanian and Natalie Qasabian, producers of the movie Searching, in theaters now, everywhere. I want to emphasize that.
Yeah.
Yes, everywhere, wherever you are, if there's a theater, it's there. Search for it.
Nice.
Right? Yeah.
Nice.
Let's talk about how you guys met, because that's sure. always interesting. So, and I'm sure yes. the audience is interested.
Yeah, so we actually met through ASA, Armenian Students Association.
Nice.
At USC. I was finishing my undergrad degree, and Sevak was actually on campus because the ASA was doing this career night where they invited, you know, people from different professions to come and talk to
right.
the current ASA students. And so we're in this like room at USC, beautiful like conference room, and it's like lawyers, doctors, real estate professionals, and then there's a table for film, and it's just Sevak. And I'm supposed to be there, but all night long I'm like running around because I was part of the ASA. And I kept being like, I want to talk to you at some point. And it's just hilarious because like there was no one at his table. And then by the end of the night, everyone went there because everyone realized he's in film. And it was so exciting to talk to a producer. But anyways, long story short, we ended up chatting. And I remember Sev was so excited because he'd just written a screenplay, not Searching. It was another film that he wrote with Anish, our writer and director of Searching. Right. And it was this big budget like action movie. And he starts pitching it to me, and I, which was very uncharacteristic of me, I cut him off halfway through, and I was like, I know how the story ends. And I basically pitched you your story, you know, very confidently.
I was so That's confused. So I'm like, awesome. How did you know my own movie? And also, like, the fact that she understood the story was impressive, and the fact that she cut me off and interrupted me, I also found very impressive. So we met thanks to USC. You know, both yeah. of us graduated from there.
Right on.
Yes.
Right on. Absolutely. Yeah. And then Nat just got her MBA, but not from USC. Yeah.
Yes, let's talk about your education and how that's sure. contributed to your art. And you guys both know I'm big on artists pursuing an education, mm-hmm. and I think that it inherently helps, you know, one another out. Yeah,
absolutely. Yeah, I think for me, because I did my undergrad at USC in film, and when I left and started working in the industry, I started to realize that, you know, that there's a lot of, you know, corporate structure to film, even though it's film and it's creative.
Right.
And, you know, long term, if I ever wanted to kind of work in the studio world or whatnot, it would probably be helpful to have somewhat of a, you know, business foundation to speak that language. So for me, it was taking my creative background and being able to put it into business terms, so to speak,
right.
and being able to, like, you know, merge those two worlds. But yeah, and it's been really exciting. I just graduated.
Congrats.
Two weeks ago. Thank you.
Yes.
And it was very fun and challenging juggling work and
I
school.
Know. How did you do that? That is amazing.
You know, I just jumped in and I really wanted to do it. I really wanted to go back to school. And I said, you know what, I'm probably going to get busier every single year. So like now's the time.
And yeah. And really a lot of people say that they're like, oh my goodness, how can you juggle all of that? Well, like it's life is always going to be busy, you
exactly.
know? So the more you said it best, like you can't
you have
just
to jump
postpone.
In.
Yeah, just jump
absolutely.
In and do it. Yeah.
Yeah.
And Sev, I know you were a lecturer at SC. So talk a little bit about
yeah,
that.
Yeah. So I went to UC San Diego for undergrad, and then I got into USC for my master's program. And about a year after I graduated from USC, they reached out and asked me if I would. I basically got a call a week before the semester started, and the person who was in charge of the producing department said that this professor had to drop out right before the semester started because he had a heart issue.
Aww.
And they asked me if I would, you know, he's okay now.
Okay,
they asked
good.
Me, they asked me if I
I'm
would
like,
jump.
Don't,
happy
don't go
sorry,
sad
sorry.
On me right
they,
now.
They asked me if I would go and substitute his class for a week or two, mm-hmm. and I said yes, which was crazy, and then they basically said, hey, you're doing a good job. Would you just stay for the rest of the semester? I said, sure. And then one semester turned into nine semesters. So I taught at USC for
wow.
a little bit over 4 years. It was funny because I remember my first day of class, the TA was older than me and much larger than me. when the students walked in, they all thought he was a professor. Uh-huh. And then I started talking and they were like, oh, okay.
Oh, they must have loved
you,
though.
And then I would go into the faculty lounge to like have lunch. And every time I'd walk in, all the professors would like look at me like, what are you doing here? And I would be like, I guess
who let the student in here?
Exactly. That's funny. I love teaching, and you know, education is a big part of, I mean, it's something that my parents really instilled in me. I'm sure just like yours. Yeah. And just like yours.
And I love that both of you guys are educated and you're following your passion, because it's very important to do what you love every day, you know? And doing it together, having a shared vision. It's a really beautiful thing from a distance watching it all unravel online. I follow both of you intensely. I'm proud of you. You know, I tell all my friends about it. And that's why I really, really encourage all of you guys, Armenian American organizations, anyone, you know, in the Armenian community and beyond, of course. But as an Armenian, it's so important to support artists like this. I mean, they're doing amazing work. So please go check out Searching. It's in theaters everywhere. And I want to leave off with you guys giving some sort of inspiration to aspiring, you know, producers, filmmakers, whatever the case may be out there, like a little bit of advice to them, maybe.
Sure. Yeah, I would say if you're thinking about it, you're not sure, just get out and try it and take any opportunity. Just go for it.
Right.
I will say that the biggest mistake I have seen people make all the time when they want to break into the filmmaking industry is there's this belief that I think is false, in which you just got to get one person to believe in you. If you can get one person to read your script, or one person to take a chance on you, or one person to like vouch for you, you'll make it. I think that's so wrong. And I know this sounds cheesy, but I think now you have to just make it, like what Natalie is saying, like you can't wait for someone to give you approval.
Go out
this there. Industry is one where you could just go out and make it yourself. Both of us kind of got our start by doing that. And I think I've seen too many people waste too many years waiting for someone else to give them that chance. All you need is yourself.
Beautiful. I love it. Thank you guys so much.
Thank you.
Thanks,
once
Maria,
again,
seriously.
Yeah, for blessing the set here. We love having you. Anytime, you're welcome to come back. And so once again, you're watching MStage. We just interviewed two very special people, Sevak Ohanian, Natalie Qasabian, producers of the movie Searching, in theaters everywhere. Thank you for tuning in, guys.